Hello to all dear students. So in this video, we shall study about functions of renal system. So renal system means kidneys, and the very first thing that comes in your mind with kidneys are excretory function. So the very first function of our renal system is excretory function. So via urine, various metabolic waste and toxin will be eliminated out of our body. Next, the second most important function of our renal system is regulatory function. Okay, regulatory function. Like it is involved in regulation of water balance. When you are consuming more amount of water, so more you are urinating. If you are consuming less water, so less you are urinating. Apart from this, electrolyte balance like sodium, potassium, calcium and various other important electrolytes should be within a physiological limit. If it is more, then it is more eliminated out of your urine and vice versa. And similarly, it is also involved in regulation of acid and base balance as well. Apart from this, our renal system have also got endocrine function. Endocrine function. And lastly, and very less popular, it have also got metabolic function. Okay, so we shall check out all these functions of our renal system one by one. So starting with the very first one, that is excretory function. Now we know whenever we consume food, some metabolic waste are been produced, and these metabolic waste are primarily eliminated out of our urine. And the, you know, the main, the important metabolic waste will be your metabolic waste will be your urea and creatinine. Okay, so urea and creatinine are the, you know, so called metabolic waste. You know, this urea and creatinine, it can be used to determine whether your kidneys are working well or not. Okay, like we have got some physiological limits, some serum creatinine and serum urea level. And if this level is been disturbed from its normal level, that implies that the kidneys are even disturbed. Okay, but among urea and creatinine, this creatinine is said to be the most important serum test to determine whether your kidneys are working well or not, because whenever creatinine level is been disturbed, that implies that the kidneys functioning is also disturbed. No doubt, even if there is disturbance in urea level, it also implies that kidneys functioning is also being disturbed. But the level of urea is being disturbed because of various other reasons. But the creatinine level is disturbed only and only whenever there is disturbance in the renal functioning. Okay, like urea level, no doubt, when kidneys are being disturbed, the urea level is also being disturbed. But suppose if any person is suffering from severe dehydration, the person is vomiting a lot, or there is a severe diarrhea, means whenever there is a severe dehydration, at that time also the level of urea will be disturbed. Okay, the level of urea will be disturbed. No doubt the kidneys will be working well, but because of dehydration, the serum urea level will be disturbed. Even if any person consume large amount of protein, like large amount of fish and chicken and mutton, so much amount of protein, if any person consume, at this condition also the level of urea will be increased. That is, it will be at a normal physiological level. Okay, abnormally high increased urea level will be there in the serum. No doubt the kidneys will be functioning well, but the urea level will be at abnormal. Okay, but in case of creatinine, if the kidneys are not functioning well, that implies that creatinine level is abnormal. Okay, so the creatinine serum creatinine test is said to be a gold standard for determining the functioning of your kidneys. Okay, so the very first excretory role of our kidneys is to remove out metabolic waste. Apart from metabolic waste, the other thing which is eliminated out of our kidneys are your drugs. Okay, so whenever you consume drugs, it is to the maximum 70 to 80 or you can say 90% of the drugs are eliminated out of our kidneys. You know, most of the drugs, they are lipophilic in nature. Okay, and these lipophilic drugs are been converted into hydrophilic, that is lipid soluble drugs are been converted into water soluble drug, and then these water soluble metabolites are been eliminated out of our kidneys, okay, via the urine. Next, apart from drugs, there are certain toxins which are also eliminated out of our kidneys. Okay, so in excretory function, basically our kidneys are involved in elimination of metabolic waste and elimination of drugs and elimination of toxin. Okay, so this was the first function. Okay, so we have completed the first function, that is the excretory function. Next, coming to the second one, that is regulatory function. Okay, so second function of our renal system is regulatory function. Now, our kidneys are basically required for maintaining a normal water balance. Okay, so suppose you are consuming large amount of fluid or large amount of liquid, then under this condition there will be large amount of urination, and if you are consuming less amount of fluid or less water, then you are eliminating less amount of urine. So basically our kidneys are maintaining a normal balance of water. Okay, and all this thing is regulated by our kidneys. Apart from this, it is also involved in maintaining a normal electrolyte balance. Okay, normal electrolyte balance, like our very important electrolytes are there, like our sodium. The normal level of sodium should be always 135 to 155 milliequivalent per liter. Okay, this is the normal level of sodium per liter, and this being maintained by our kidneys. If you are consuming large amount of sodium, then large amount of sodium will be eliminated out of our urine. Okay, so that the level of sodium should be within a physiological limit. And similarly, we have got normal level of potassium also. Okay, so normal potassium level is be around 4 to 6 milliequivalent per liter. Okay, so every time all this maintenance of these electrolytes within the physiological limit, it is been done, this work is been carried out by our renal system. Apart from this, it is also involved in maintaining a normal acid-base balance. Okay, in our body, large amount of metabolic reactions are been taking place, and for these reactions, we require enzymes, and these enzymes will be activated under some kind of pH is been required, and that normal pH is been maintained by our kidneys. Okay, so kidneys are also involved in maintenance of a normal acid and base balance. Okay, so this is all about the regulatory function of our renal system. Next, coming to the third function, that is the endocrine functions. Now we have got large amount of endocrine glands and we have got endocrine hormones. So what exactly do you mean by these endocrine glands and endocrine hormones? It means that there are few set of cells that will be releasing some kind of products, and these products will be flowing along with the blood and it will be moving to some other group of cells, and these products will be acting on that other group of cells. Okay, so some cells are producing some products and that products are producing action on some other cells. So this is what the ideology of endocrine glands and endocrine hormones. Okay, now regarding our renal system, the endocrine function over here is, it is involved in the synthesis of erythropoietin. You know, erythropoietin, which is very much necessary for the synthesis of our red blood cells. Apart from this, our renal system have also got the role of producing renin and also prostaglandins. Okay, now we'll see little bit about this erythropoietin. So basically what happens over here is, suppose this is our nephron, one nephron I'm making, this is Bowman's capsule. Proximal convoluted tubule, loop of Henle, then distal convoluted tubule, and lastly, this is our collecting ducts. Okay, and you know, this proximal convoluted tubules, these are made up of specialized epithelial cells, cuboidal epithelium, and these are made up of columnar epithelium. Okay, now beside this we have got a blood vessel that is known as the peritubular blood vessels, and you know, these blood vessels, these are made up of endothelial lining. Okay, basically these are capillaries, and erythropoietin production mainly depends upon the cells of this endothelial lining. Okay, so I'm be zooming one cell and you will get to know. Suppose this is one of the endothelial cell. Okay, this is one of the endothelial cells. This is the nucleus. Now this endothelial cell have got a very important protein. Okay, and the name of this protein is oxygen sensor. Okay, so what this oxygen sensor will do, whenever blood comes over here, it will be sensing oxygen, and whenever it is sensing oxygen, it will get activated, and after getting activated, it will be moving inside the nucleus. Now inside the nucleus, there will be one gene which is responsible for producing erythropoietin. So this oxygen sensing protein, whenever it will get activated, it will move inside the nucleus and it will inhibit this gene. Okay, but suppose if any person is suffering from anemia, okay, if the person is suffering from anemia, means in the blood there will be less amount of oxygen, and if there is less amount of oxygen means this oxygen sensing protein, it will not be able to sense the oxygen, so it will not get activated. Okay, when it is not getting activated, it is not able to inhibit this gene, so that means this gene is now properly working. Okay, so properly working means it will undergo transcription, because of which, you know, it will cause production of mRNA, and this mRNA, it will move to the ribosome, because of which it will start producing a protein, that is erythropoietin protein, and this erythropoietin protein will be removed out of this cell, and then it will be moving to the bone marrow, and it will cause production of red blood cells. Okay, so this is how kidneys are responsible for, you know, production of this erythropoietin and thereby RBC. And this is the reason why if any person, if his both the kidneys are not working well, they are not, means if the both the kidneys are being failed, then such kind of person are also suffering from anemia. Why? Because there is no erythropoietin. Okay, there is no production of erythropoietin in the peritubular capillaries. Okay, so any person whose kidneys are not working well, or both the kidneys are dysfunctional, means such kind of person are basically facing the problem of anemia also. So this is about the erythropoietin. Okay, next another thing is renin production. Kidneys are also responsible for formation of renin. You know, renin is an enzyme which is responsible for conversion of angiotensinogen into angiotensin 1, and then gradually angiotensin 1 will be converted into angiotensin 2 by the enzyme angiotensin converting enzyme, and this angiotensin 2, it will cause, you know, activation of sympathetic nervous system, and it will also produce constriction of veins and arteries, and it will increase the blood pressure. So basically this renin synthesis is done by the kidneys. Okay, so in kidneys what happens, you know, suppose this is your blood vessel coming towards the nephron, this is afferent arteriole and this is the efferent arteriole. Now this afferent arteriole, this part have got some specialized cells. This specialized cell is known as Polkinson cells. Okay, so the afferent arteriole have got a specialized cells known as Polkinson cells, and this nephron, you know, this distal convoluted tubule is made up of columnar epithelium. Okay, but this part have got some specialized columnar epithelium. Okay, and this specialized columnar epithelium is known as macula densa. Okay, so this specialized afferent arteriole cell, that is Polkinson, and this specialized distal convoluted tubular cells, that is macula densa, this together, this Polkinson and macula densa together form a part known as the juxtaglomerular cells, JG cells. Okay, and inside this JG cells will be caused production of renin. Okay, so whenever this JG cells gets activated, it will cause production of renin. Okay, so this is how renin is being produced by our kidneys. Apart from this, there are a lot of cells which are responsible for production of prostaglandins from the renal system. Okay, so this was the endocrine function of our kidneys. Now coming to the last one, that is the fourth one, the metabolic function of kidney. Now, you know, kidneys are basically responsible for activation of vitamin D inside our body. You know what happens? You know, because of sun, we'll be getting vitamin D. So suppose this is sun and this is our skin. So whenever sun rays falls on our skin will start producing a substance known as cholecalciferol. Okay, cholecalciferol. Next, what happens? This cholecalciferol, it will be moving to our liver. Okay, cholecalciferol will enter into the liver, and when it will be exiting the liver, it will become 25-hydroxycholecalciferol. Means one hydroxyl group will be added at the 25th position of cholecalciferol. Next, when it will be moving across our kidneys, this 25-hydroxycholecalciferol, it will be converted into 1,25-dihydroxycholecalciferol, which is an active form of vitamin D. Okay, so basically kidneys are responsible for activation of our vitamin D. So basically what happens over here is, this proximal convoluted cells, here it contains an enzyme. The name of this enzyme is alpha 1 hydroxylase. Okay, so whenever this 25-hydroxycholecalciferol, it will be moving to kidneys, basically it is in the proximal convoluted tubule that contains the enzyme alpha 1 hydroxylase, that will convert the 25-hydroxycholecalciferol into 1,25-dihydroxycholecalciferol, which is an active form of vitamin D. And this is the role, that is the metabolic role of our kidneys. Okay, so these all are the functions of our renal system: excretory function, regulatory function, endocrine function, and metabolic function. So this was all about our today's video regarding the functions of our renal system. I hope you people found this video helpful. Thank you for watching.